So on behalf of the MHRD Institution Innovation Council, Deendayal Upadhyaya College, which is organizing this program under the aegis of DBT Star College program. That's a program is all about Atmanirbhar Bharat webinar series. And this is supported by National Academy of Sciences Delhi chapter and IEEE Electron Device Society Delhi chapter. So today we have with us Dr. Ajay Agarwal, who is a coordinator of Smart Sensor Area, CSIR CERI, which is Central Electronics Engineering Research Institute, and also professor in Academy of Scientific and Innovation Research, Pilani, Rajasthan. Now, before proceeding further, I would like my colleague, Dr. Poonam Kasturi, who is also the convener of the DBT Star College program in electronics, kindly introduce Dr. Ajay Agarwal.
Thank you, Manoj.
Yeah.
Good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to introduce Dr. Ajay Agarwal. Dr. Ajay Agarwal is Senior Principal Scientist, Coordinator in the area, and Head Nano Biosensors Group at CSIR, Central Electronics Engineering Research Institute, Pilani. He's involved in development of nanotechnologies, MEMS, microfluidics, and microsensors. He's also professor at Academy of Scientific and Innovative Research, New Delhi. Earlier, as member of technical staff, he served Institute of Microelectronics, Singapore for over 9 years. His engagement with semiconductor industries and research institutes is for over 3 decades. He has almost 280 research publications in peer-reviewed journals or international conferences, over 60 invited plenary keynote talks, and over 35 patents granted or filed. He's bestowed with various awards, including 2008 National Technology Award Singapore, 2009 Excellence Award IME Singapore, Collaborative Development Award British High Commission Singapore for year 2005 and 2006. So, four times and 7 times at Usha India Limited, etc. He has been instrumental in several collaborative projects with industry universities like Sony, Japan, Opaldia, UK, Siemens, Singapore, Innovations, Australia, Silverbrook, Ireland, Australia, ST Kinetics, Singapore, Panasonic, Japan, Intelligent Chip Connection, Singapore, NUS, N2E, University of London, and many more. Some of his achievements include the development of silicon nanowire-based devices, including electronic biochemical sensor system, integrated with fluidics and readout electronics, development of biochips like lateral patch clamp arrays, microfluidics on transparent substrates, cell sorter cum counter, microviscometer, and many more. Silicon-based nanostructured substrates for surface-enhanced Raman spectroscopy, gas sensors, etc. He's also contributed significantly in the development of silicon micromirror arrays, polysilicon interconnects for 3D stacking, implantable neural probes, and many more. We welcome you, sir, and the stage is for you now. Thank you.
So, good morning, and first of all, thank you, Dr. Manoj and Dr. Poonam, for a wonderful starting of that session. And this is an important series when I came to know about Atmanirbhar Bharat series going on. And in this time of pandemic, we all are locked down at our homes. So why not share some of these meaningful things where we can all contribute? I understand the audience today are from various fields, and many of you are faculties or students also, research students. So as the topic suggests, engineering solutions. So we'll be talking more on the engineering part of point of care and early diagnostic solutions. So that is a target today. I would like to thank again to the organizers and the agencies like NASI who have supported this series. Before I go ahead with the talk, let me briefly introduce my institute. This is my institute, and we have an iconic tower here. So I come from CIRI, briefly we call it. This is a CSIR institute, and we have three research areas here. So cyber physical system, if you see, this is a system, electronic systems related activities are done in this area. And second is microwave devices. So this is the division where CIRI started the activities. These are high power, high frequency devices, mainly for defense application. And area number three, the smart sensor area. So I take care of this area. I belong to this area. And this is mainly on focusing on sensors. So earlier this was a semiconductor device area, and now we are focusing on sensors. So as you know, when we talk of sensors, it's not only silicon now, different materials can be used for sensor applications. So I belong to this area. And this is the strength of CIRI. You can see here, we are about 100 plus scientists. We have project fellows here, about 50 of these project fellows. This number moves from 30, 40 to 100 plus. So these are our young scientist pool who work in our projects. So since March, large number of projects ended because of the financial year, and new projects have not started yet because of this pandemic situation only. That's why this number is slightly low here, but at times this can go to 100 also. UHFs are young scientists which are appointed as ad hoc scientists in our lab. And research fellows, all government fellowships, students are working in our labs also. And this is a very good pool of scientists. About 150 technical staff are there who help us in our operations of the labs. And as mentioned earlier, we are a part of an academy, ACSIR, and we have a good pool of PhD and master's students. We do not take undergraduates, so we are supervisors and teach them for the courses for master's and PhD. So that's about my institute. Okay, so we move to the topic today. What we have today is point of care. Point of care is also called rapid diagnostic technique, RDT. So point of care, as the name suggests, the place where there is a need, we need to do some diagnostic there. So that's why it has to be rapid. So what is this point of care? So these are some examples. I have taken a slide from the internet. And we all know the glucose testing is done at home. And this is for monitoring purpose. And it's very common. India has about 7 crore diabetic people. So people need to monitor that are the glucose level in the blood is in control or it is going beyond the level. And same way you can see the pregnancy test is a common test which is done at home. A lady need not go to hospital or clinic for that purpose. So these are some of the examples. And there are so many products of this kind available in the market. Now, what are the use cases? Where this point of care, are they only used in the home only? No, that's not the case. So these are the 5 use cases if you see. The first vertical if you see here, this is home. And what we are doing, self-assessment. And in case there is a level going higher, we need to refer a doctor. So that's the first case. And we already know there are a lot of cases. The another case comes in the community. This is for the screening again. So here, a healthcare worker, which is very minimally trained, is going to a village or a remote area and do a screening of a cohort. And this is how this point of care, so immediately they have to know if the person might be infected or having a condition what the test is done. If you see the today's case of COVID-19, this is the scenario where we need a screening and which is missing at this moment. Community level screening, if can be done, this is very much needed at this moment. So this is a need. moving further, if you go to a clinic, you go to see a doctor, you want immediate diagnostic to be done. So that is another application for point of care. Fine. And here, based on this diagnosis done, the treatment is also prescribed immediately by the doctor. Another case comes in the peripheral labs. So these are the testing labs. So testing labs, they do traditional testing, and they also look for a point of care devices so that they can give a result of your test immediately there. And these are also for monitoring. So we go to, when the equipment is slightly costly, so people go there and get it tested or for continuous monitoring once in a month or once in a 6 months time, they can go to peripheral labs. And third, the last case where this point of care are used are in hospitals, inpatients. So the patients are in hospital, and on the bedside, we need to monitor a lot of activities there related to the patient's condition. And these are also the point of care devices also find application on the bedside of a patient. So these are some five different cases, and these all are important. And their features slightly vary. For example, if you take a community screening, you may like to have IoT enabled device. That means when you are doing a screening of a cohort, you want that data to be sent to a server and recorded. So that way you know that really what testing was done, who was the person, and what was the result. So that we know, like in our today's case, if we have a lot of quarantine centers, and when we are moving from one town to other town, people are quarantined for 14 days. So if you can have a quick screening there, you do a screening, and you know who are infected or likely to be infected because of some tests done, and they can be isolated from the other people. So all people just in quarantine, some may be affected, may not be affected. So the chances of cross-contamination from one person to another reduces. So this data and these features depend on. Now coming to early diagnosis, early detection. There are so many cases. I'll go through this slide also, but think of cancer. Cancer is detected when something very typical happens in a person's behavior or in a body. Some symptoms are there. So if you move from, this is for the infectious I have taken. So say from the left-hand side, when there is exposure, when we see a star, so there is exposure. For some period of time, nothing will appear in the body. So like today, person is infected, no symptoms onset. So this is the incubation period. And this can happen up to, in present case of a coronavirus, it could be something like 7 to 14 days or even more. So there are exceptions. Person is carrying this virus, but there is no symptom visible and there is no test. So if we have early detection device, we can do a screening here. And there is an assessment that the person needs to be isolated and some treatment might be given if required. So what happens in these cases? There is a symptom onset. And because of that symptom, like in coughing or some fever, there is a behavioral change in the health. And then only we are taking some advice. Forget about this COVID, but this is a general case. Like we have a flu. We have some cough and cold with nothing, so we are not doing some assessment or we take something at the home level, but advice is taken at this level only. And if it prolongs further, we are going to GP. GP is our first level doctor, and there we are going for medicine. So you can think of how many days it has already lapsed. So if you have a screening, it has to be at very early. And if you have a device to detect, that is also a challenge. Can you detect at this stage or this stage? That is a big challenge. I'll discuss about that one. And once we go to GP, they ask for the testing, and the test results sometimes come in 2 days, 3 days, and then the diagnosis is done, and once it is confirmed, and then treatment starts. So it takes some time. It's not because doctor don't want to do a test. The techniques what we have are not able to detect these symptoms or these conditions of the patients. I'll talk more about this one, how early detection helps, and I'll take some cases also. So when we go for point of care device or early detection, it has a sensor. It's a biosensor. And this table is quite busy. So I'll take you through very slowly on this one. We'll spend some time on this one. Just see this leftmost vertical. And these are the typical samples we collect. If you take the second one here, human samples could be blood, urine, saliva, in current cases, swab from the throat. Or so these are the samples typically taken. Or why these samples? We are looking for some cells. If it is a other sample, like a food sample, many times we have to test the food. If it is okay, it's contaminated. So this is these are some food samples. And environmental samples are air, water, soil, and sometimes vegetations. So these are the typical samples need to be tested for any condition. This blue box, two boxes what we are I'm predicting here, this is a biosensor. If you see the third vertical here, these are different kind of devices or electrical interfaces. So we focus, when we are engineer, we are focusing here. So engineer's role or the material science people role comes here. What device to be chosen for what purpose? So there is a trick here, and there is a some knowledge required that how to detect a device, how to detect a condition. Like, say if I have a sample here, which has some charge, I want that charge to come on my FET device, either this FET device or nanowire FET, and that charge should work as a gate and change my drain current. So how much charge I am bringing, what concentration of charge I have to detect, I have to decide what FET I have to use. Now, why that charge only be affecting my channel current? I have to put some chemicals on the surface, which is called surface modification, so that I specifically bind my analyte on this one. Correct? So I want charge to come on this, but I want specifically only, because these charges are, or when we say charge, let me tell you one more thing. Most of these testing is done using some marker. So our blood, say for example, if we take our blood, blood has RBC, which is the red cells, WBC, which are the white cells, and some platelets are there, and there are thousands of proteins inside. So these protein molecules are markers for a lot of different conditions in our body. When a disease or a situation comes in our body, so the balance of these protein changes. Some of these protein start increasing at very early stage. I take an example of a heart condition. There are markers like troponin I, troponin K, myoglobin, CKMB. So these are the, so if there are audience in the biology, they understand very well. I'm not a biologist, so I'll not be able to answer those questions much, but there are so many markers there. Some of them start increasing almost a few days before the stroke can come. And their concentration increases to the peak, and then some other starts increasing after some time. So if you can detect these markers well before the stroke comes, person can be, their life can be saved. Or we can avoid the stroke, heart attack. So we want to detect these proteins specifically, and most of these proteins are charged molecules, but they need to be binded on the surface of our sensor specifically. And that is done by the bioreceptors. Or sometimes you are looking for DNA changes to be recorded. So complementary DNAs need to be fixed here. So chemistry plays an important role in fixing these receptors on the surface. What surface condition has to be prepared so that we can bind these, and then they will be specifically binding the analytes. So this is how it goes. Now, when analyte comes on the surface, there is a change, electrical change, either the current changes in the, this one, or there is a potential change, or sometimes color changes happen. So it depends on the what kind of chemistry we work, or sometimes there is a fluorescence. So those signals are electronic signals. So we are interested in those electronic signals. And many a times these signals, or the changes on these signals, are very, very less. So you need amplification. So here comes the circuit. Circuit people come play an important role. What kind of circuit need to be there? We want it to be small, handheld, and accurate. There are a lot of noise in our system. Environmental noise, system noise, we have to avoid those. A lot of controls need to be built within the sensor and the system. Because when we are testing, we are not isolating the markers. We don't know the markers. There are a lot of other garbage material in the sample, which will also create some noise. So we have to take care of that one. And then that signal processing required. And this is also playing an important role. Many a times we have a multiple sensors together. So we have multiple signals coming up, and then comes the AI. And AI plays an important role in signal processing, and then output is now displayed either quantitatively, what is the quantity of that marker, or many a times for a screening, yes, no, that is good enough. So this is how it works. So you can appreciate here micro nano technologies are there, material people are there, process people plays an important role. In the end, I will say, as part of Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan of Government of India, let's realize some POCs and early diagnostic solutions together, which are relevant for our society, Indian society, and we can do it. We are not dependent on foreign technologies or other things. This is the time we have to join hands, and we can really do it for our society. And for references, this is a link for my Google Scholar, and all these papers are there. I have not put all the references there, but more than that are there, so you can refer there. Thank you very much. I can be contacted there. This is my email ID, and I acknowledge the effort of my colleagues and students who have worked with me at CV Pilani and at my earlier institution, IME Singapore. Thank you very much.
Mention this thing. That till far, whatever number of lectures which we have organized, today's attendance is the largest. So that has crossed around 170. And this is something which is commendable. And I really thank Dr. Ajay for sharing his valuable time with all of us. And hope to see you around, all the attendees, as well as Dr. Ajay, in some other future program of ours in that case.
Yeah, my pleasure. I'll be.
Definitely. And I would like to thank all my attendees and my coordinators, Dr. Poonam Kasturi, as well as the organizing team, which is pertaining of National Academy of Sciences, India Delhi Chapter, Professor Ajoy Katak, who is the chairperson, Professor Mridula Gupta, is IEEE EDS Delhi Chapter Chair, and my college authorities, our principal, and all my colleagues who have helped me all throughout these last 4 or 5 days in motivating students to join this session. Thank you very much.